Cafe races may be a worldwide phenomenon, but to trace their origins, we visited one of the birthplaces of cafe racer culture, London's Ace Cafe. The Ace is just one of dozens of roadside transport cafes that provided a gathering place for speed-obsessed motorcyclists in mid-century England. In 1994, former policeman and avid biker Mark Willsmore held a reunion for riders who frequented the Ace during its heyday. When thousands of riders turned up for the event, it prompted Willsmore to reopen the cafe and restore it to its former glory.
Well, I'm not old enough to have been here first time round, but the cafe opened originally in 1938 as the road out to the south of our car park here, the North Circular, had opened not long before that. An arterial or a main trunk route around the northern side of London. And this was a typical transport cafe of its day. During the following couple of years, war broke out and this whole area was flattened in an air raid. And the building we're now in was built in 1948 as a cafe and restaurant. Subsequently closed in 1969. And I came along in 94, organised a reunion 25 years after it had closed, and eventually in 2001 the place fully reopened as you see now. But its history includes a period particularly after the Second World War, 1940s into the 50s and 60s, where the British motorcycle industry was at its fullest strength, huge numbers of bikes being produced. And the baby boom generation took to those bikes as being the cheapest means of transport that they could acquire. And having bought motorbikes, they then would gather, as youngsters do to this day, to talk their interests and passions, and having a vehicle, putting guys together, they'd race their bikes on the stretch of road out here, at which time there were no speed limits, no laws about what tests they'd have to take, and of course kids racing vehicles without any sort of management at all can only produce carnage. And the carnage that was produced a national outcry in the newspapers and in TV and on the radio, to the extent that in essence a whole culture came to be termed Tun-up Boy, Leather Boy, and eventually Rockers.
Hunger to make their ordinary street bikes go faster and resemble the machines ridden by British racing heroes like Mike Hailwood and Jeff Duke was all part of the cafe racer ethos.
Transport cafes, I guess, would be the equivalent of what you would call diners in the States, where the busy arterial trunk roads, as we call them, maybe in the States your freeways and your interstates, you would have pull-offs where you get your gas, we call petrol over here, but where you get your gas and you get your food. And invariably, these are at the edges of town. They're on straight, fast stretches of road and quite appealing for people with vehicles to meet at. And the other great attraction of cafes, and I suspect diners in the States at that time, was the jukebox. And certainly in this country, when rock and roll was first came around in the mid-50s, you could only hear rock and roll on a jukebox. There was no radio stations playing it, no clubs playing it. So this new music of youngsters mixed with having their own vehicles and their own identity, along comes this identity, the Tun-up Boy and his bike, the Cafe Racer, because invariably the racing would be from one cafe to another. The party piece so I'm told, was to come past here flat out, which is around about 100 mile an hour on a 650 twin, and someone pulls out and you're doing 100 mile an hour coming along here, you're dead. And lots of people came to grief at that junction. The other party piece was to go from here either east towards what's called the Iron Bridge, the S-Bends. There's a big heavy metal iron bridge on a S-Bend. When you exited that S-Bend, there was a roundabout. That's now superseded by straightforward carriageway, different junction layout entirely now, made a lot safer. But it's either to race from here east, crossing 1, 2, 3, 4 junctions to the roundabout and back, or to the roundabout to the west of here called Hanger Lane, where there are were two junctions to cross. And invariably, if you were racing, it didn't matter if those lights were red. You just went through them, or not, as the case may be. Quite mad. But again, in the context of the period, the 50s and the 60s, it's the time of the atom bomb and the commies conquering space, and we could all be dead in 2 minutes at the press of a button. So the psychology, I suggest, of youngsters and that particular backdrop is, well, we might as well enjoy today because we might not be here tomorrow. And that was played out in full colour out here.
Well, why do you treat me so mean? You're the meanest thing I've ever seen. You're letting me hold you tight. You're letting me love you right. How about you know I love you, so why do you do me like you do? Do what you want to do.
With credit easily available, few police patrol vehicles capable of matching the speed of a well-tuned motorcycle, and little in the way of national speed limits, motorcycle sales skyrocketed in late 50s England. By then, countless teens yearned to don the black leather jackets and Royal Air Force-inspired gear of the Turnup Boys, who were making headlines across the country. Having grown up in nearby Kensal Rise, North London, right near the centre of the action, Dave Johnson was one of them.
I would say somewhere like 60, 61, 62 onwards. Where I lived at Neasden, which is a few miles straight down that way. Went to school with all the other lads, all the other people in the area, kids in the area. And one day I heard them talking about a cafe they go to the evening. Asked them about it, and I came down with the older boys from school, and we got a bus from Neasden where I live. We got off the bus up the top here, and we was walking down, you know, and I was sort of really amazed. The place in itself was lit up completely. It was like its own little atmosphere it had down here. Cars in and out, lorries in and out, people, and it was a brilliant place. I had a little 125 Bantam, small little two-stroke, plunger frame. To me, it was brilliant. When you haven't got much money, and when you get on that, you've got the freedom of road to go anywhere. You know, it was brilliant. You know, not have to keep waiting for buses and walking everywhere, or push biking. I went up in the world. Well, I thought I did anyway. I got it was a 500cc. It was a Tiger 100 come 5TA. Unit construction Triumph. It was one that was made up. It was made up by a few friends of mine. I used to knock about with them. Where are they now? I don't know. But it was a marvellous bike because it used to just get me anywhere, everywhere. I used to really enjoy it, you know. But I had that all through the 60s and everything. I didn't really want anything faster. That was fast enough for me. It was reliability you wanted as well, you know, back in them days. Well, I've had mates down here with trying out bikes, combinations. We had the sidecar there with just a board of wood on it, you know, screwed down, everything. I'd been round on that, and it's hairy, that was, so I wouldn't want to do that again. But we're sort of invincible in them days, you know. You fell off and you scraped along the floor, you got back up, you was cut, bruised. I've had lost some of my teeth and bent my nose and scraped him, but you just accepted it in them days. You accepted it.
Though thousands of men and women tested their homemade machines and their mettle on the roads of Great Britain during the turn-up era, some riders became legends for not only their love of speed, but their love of mischief as well. For several years during the late 1950s, Barry Noddy Cheese was king on the North Circular Road.
I think that's when I got nicked outside, when the police used to use these little velocettes and they used to call them Noddy Men. And rather than... the idea of Noddy Men came from... They used to actually salute their sergeants, but they wasn't allowed to take their hands off the handlebars, so they used to nod, so that's where they got their name from. And I got nicked outside in front of all the lads. I was on my Bonneville, and I forgot to turn the petrol on. And there I was getting a ticking off outside of the Ace Cafe. Well, I started coming down the Ace Cafe about 56, 57, and I've been asked a lot of times, what was the Ace Cafe really like? And I can tell you, and sum that up, if you look at an old Wild West film of Wild Earth cleaning up Dodge City, that's exactly how the Ace Cafe was. Great days, and, you know, and we used to make the rules up as we used to go along. Because don't forget, when you look at this road now, it's completely different with the underpass, but we had the old bridges and the sound from the exhaust, the notes of the exhaust, it was great. And we'd come past here and all the lads would be here with the old Bill behind us, the old police behind us, chasing us. We lost lots of lads down here. I'm afraid it was a regular thing going to the funerals, and it was a sad time for us all, you know. I mean, I've got lots of my friends have gone now. And I don't make new friends easy now, because it's, you know, when you lose friends, you find it difficult to make new friends, because it's too painful when you lose them. Always did our own maintenance. But if you didn't know what you were doing, there was plenty of lads down here, and we all used to muck in. If somebody passed here with anything, we'd have it in here. Didn't have to call the AA or the RAC. We'd do it for them. And there was never no charge for it. Cup of tea, you might get a cup of tea or a fag out of you.
What would you do to make your motorcycles faster back in the cafe?
All sorts of things. Change the jets and the carbs, take the exhaust off. We was a bit naive then until we realised, you know, but we learnt as we went along. And just changed the bike around, customised it to our own effect. Made it a cafe racer, you know. But we had some fun down here, especially with the police. We was all regular customers up to the magistrates' court. And then eventually we got fed up with that. So what we decided to do in those days, we used to take our number plates off and then we used to put a black background on and then you could put your own numbers on. So we used to go down the shop, put the black background on, and then just before the guy asked you what the number was, you used to go outside the shop and whoever happened to be passing, and some old bloke on a... that we'd take his number and put his, you know. And of course, them days, we could, after that, we never used to bother to stop, you know. I mean, there used to be an old saying on here, like people say, what was you doing? I said, look, don't worry about that. There's only two positions on our throttle, off and on, mate. We don't worry about things like that. But there was one instance where we had a big transporter coming down the North Circular Road with a six police escort. And they parked outside here, because right opposite the Ace used to be a big lay-by. And they pulled in, the driver wanted a cup of tea, and they all came over here. So one of my mates said to me, I wonder what those Thunderbirds are like, you know, and I said, well, probably a bit heavy with all that radio equipment on. So I went over there, put the old spakey in, started the bike up, and I thought all the lads were cheering. So I thought I'd give them a real treat, turned the blue lights on, and there we were, up and down and all, on their bikes, like, great fun.
As the ranks of the cafe racers grew, so did the cult of speed surrounding them. With Britain's notorious tabloid newspapers in need of a new villain, the Rockers and Turn-Up Boys made a convenient target for exaggerated stories of death and destruction. The reputation of the Rockers took its most severe beating when they began clashing with groups of scooter-riding kids, known as mods, at seaside resorts during the early 1960s. Though accounts vary as to how bad the violence was, the period helped to solidify the Rockers' rough, tough image.
We used to mix with the mods. The mods and us, but we all got on really well together, even sort of helped them out, keep their scooters going. You know, we sort of taught them sometimes how to fix them and, you know, why they wouldn't start. They used to come up and we always used to take the piss out of each other, you know, like have a go at each other. But that was life back in them days. Mods are... They had a different form of transport, scooters, but they followed the fashion of the day, of the early 60s. The clothes, the hair, their groups were different. Music was changing. Where I liked the old rock and roll, being a greaser or a rocker. I loved the rock and roll and all that. To them, that was old fashioned. Yeah, I can well understand that. I can understand it, you know. And the difference between them is they were clean, we were dirty.
It was the sort of thing my father wouldn't want me associated with. I was always, there's no way you're having a motorbike ever. You know. And in fact, I learned to ride my first motorcycle off-road, and he thought I'd get that completely out of my system. And actually, what it made me do was just want the biggest, baddest thing you could get, which was a Vincent. It was a bad days in that respect. You know, you wouldn't be allowed into pubs, you'd get thrown out of hotels. You know, people didn't want to know you. You'd be signs outside pubs, no leathers in here, and this sort of thing. I've been in pubs many times in the past where you get there and I've got my leather jacket on and my helmet's left out on the bike and they won't serve you. You've got leathers on. It's that association with leathers, motorbikes, trouble, which I'm very pleased is now gone. Well, tell me,
baby, who's your love of mine? In addition to the clashes with the mods, rockers became known for playing other dangerous games. There were numerous reports of something called record racing. Some say record racing was an exaggerated media story, while others claim it was commonplace at cafes from the Busy Bee all the way to Cafe Rising Sun.
What it consisted of is jukebox, and every cafe back then had a jukebox, the only place you could hear rock and roll. Tracks were all about 3 minutes long, if I'm not mistaken. Coin in, and then out onto your bike, up to Hanger Lane and back again before the record finished. And again, that's just the recipe for carnage, basically.
Despite the negative headlines and mounting pressure for helmet laws, national speed limits, and a ban on motorcyclists younger than 16 riding these fast machines, there emerged a movement to rehabilitate the image of British rockers and turn-up boys. In 1962, a motorcycling preacher by the name of Father Bill Shergold offered bikers the chance to congregate in his London parish. That was the start of the motorcycle section of the 59 Club, a church youth mission that attracted thousands of riders who performed good deeds and charity work aimed at improving the public perception of bikers.